1986, so all the steel structure was built near Birmingham in 1886. And it was sent out like as a flat pack. So it all bolts together, it all slots in together. Even these columns are all in sections and they're joined by these beautiful little rose clamps, which you can't buy Bunnings, obviously. And then the building was constructed out of local stone and concrete rendered. The building goes about 3 metres into the ground. The walls are about 2 metres wide at the base and it tapers to about 50 centimetres up the top. But the inside stays the same. Yeah, it's on Netflix.
This is going to be epic, guys. We're going up the lighthouse. Slight problem. Goodness me. Yeah. Oh my goodness. Ooh, I think that's the backup battery that they're talking about. Oh, it's getting darker. There is a lot of stairs, so. Yeah, wow.
Another window, and they used to run a secondary light here as a backup light. The original plans had this window a couple of stories up, and it was a bit of a princess's balcony. It looked pretty cool on the plan, but for some reason they changed their plan towards the end and decided to put it down here. So the original lights they were running were like this kerosene lantern, and so the lighthouse keeper's job was to make sure that it was burning all night, but they soon decided that this was useless down here because if a ship could see this without any magnification, they're already on the rocks and in trouble. So they decided it was too much effort to keep two lights running all night. They decided to seal this up and only focus on the one upstairs. This photo up here on the left is a photo of a ship that ran aground near Lorne. And it stayed there for about a month on this rock. And they left the sails up, and they don't know why. And they had to wait there for this steam tugboat to come from Melbourne. And what you see there is people would come down and get their photos taken with the ship in the background, have a picnic on the rocks. They eventually pulled it off, and it would continue to sail and continue to service the area. This other ship here on the right there, that's one that ran aground and was destroyed. So the lighthouse was here before the Great Ocean Road was constructed. So the Great Ocean Road was constructed by returned servicemen from the First World War, about 4,000 of them. They came from inland down tracks to the coast and established camps. They ran about three camps and then proceeded to excavate the road by hand. Shovel, pick, no excavators, no explosives, because the cliffs are very fragile. Even today we get landslides. So it took about 5-6 years to construct it. Even when you drive down there today, you'll see that there's continual roadworks trying to maintain it. Not only do we get landslides onto the road, we also get the road sliding onto the beach. So there's heaps of work, especially around Wye River. Wye River was shut off from in both directions for about a month last year from landslides. So can you imagine what that does to the tourist industry when you've got 250 buses coming down here every day and the Great Ocean Road's closed and they have to go the inland route. Sinks. It's about four rows of LED lights.
Yeah. It's only tiny.
So big lighthouse, small light. So
This lighthouse currently gets 33 kilometres out to sea. It can be seen. The original kerosene lantern would get about 28 kilometres out to sea. So, yeah, not much difference. So what makes it work is the glass lens that's around there. So that's the original lens that came out from Birmingham. It's called a Fresnel lens. So a Fresnel lens is, if you've got a magnifying glass, you look at the magnifying glass side on it, it's a D.
Yeah.
So a Fresnel lens, it's cut in sections and you can compress it. I used to get these little plastic credit cards that were magnifiers, credit card size things you keep in your pocket. So that's what a Fresnel is. But this is three-dimensional. So all the light sources, including this one and the kerosene lantern, are diffuse light sources. That means light goes everywhere. But what the lens does, it concentrates it down into the front there, the front part of the lens, and sends it out to sea as a bright light. The lighthouse people, when they're burning the kerosene lantern, so they had to watch that all night to make sure it was burning, not burning too rich, not creating too much smoke. The more smoke meant you had to clean more. The flame had to be a certain height within the lens to get the maximum effect. So they literally had to watch the light all night, and they had three lighthouse keepers at any one time. They used to work in shifts, and up here they had a pipe phone. Do you know what a pipe phone is?
It's like the thing on playgrounds where...
Yeah, it's a pipe.
And
your pipe, you just talk into it. And the pipe phone went from up here, they have them in submarines and in ships as well. And the pipe phone went all the way from up here, down, under the road, went into a junction box, and then it split off into the bedrooms of the lighthouse keepers' cottages, so they could talk to them, and they could blow a whistle in them to wake them up, or, you know, if they needed help, or a ship was signalling to them that they were in distress. So it's the pipe phone's no longer in here, and I'm assuming that was where all this electrical cabling goes now. And I should put out on the sides to see the red, the red filters. So they are indicate the danger zone. So if you're in a ship and you see the light as red, and you'll see it when you're driving from Anglesey, you'll see it as red. That means you're either on land or you're very close to land. And so you're in danger. And so out here, we have that Ingoldsby Reef system, which goes all the way to Bell's Beach. And out here, we have the bay towards Lawn, where there is some other reefs. So if you see it as red, you're in danger, you need to head out to sea. If you see the light as white, you're safe. When they first built it, they had it around the wrong way. So whilst it was a coordinated effort to help ships get towards Melbourne, there was some lack of coordination in the government even back then. So, and after the kerosene lantern, they went to acetylene and they introduced the flasher. So this was then able to flash. So it flashes four times in 10 seconds and then it has a 10 second break, just like this LED does. So that makes each lighthouse has a unique flashing sequence. So each lighthouse has a unique flashing sequence, so the ship's captains can look at it and confirm exactly what they're seeing, is where they are. So with this device and with this device, the sun valve, the lighthouse became automated. So when the sun came up and shines on these rods, they would expand and they'd shut off a valve and shut off the acetylene. When the sun went down and these rods cooled down, it would open up the valve and let the acetylene flow. So then it became automated. And about after a year of running it with this, just to check it was working, they got rid of the lighthouse keepers. And the lighthouse keeper at that time, he would he scratched a hole in the side of the lighthouse so he could sit at the pub was down in the valley, and he could drink beer and make sure the lighthouse was working. And so he was so confident that they ended up getting rid of them. So when they got rid of them, they rented out the cottages and then they eventually sold them. Then in the 70s, they went to all different types of electric lights to what we ended up with here today. So this runs on two circuits, so even if one circuit fails, half the lights will still work, and that's still enough for for it to operate like sufficient guidance.
So where does the message go that only half of it's working, so someone comes and fixes it?
It goes to Brisbane.
Typical. Why am I not surprised?
Hey, at least it's not the Philippines, is it?
No, that was my next thought.
And then they send out a crew. So there's a crew that come and look after the lighthouse, and they'll just turn up, and if they get an error signal or we identify that there's a problem, like somebody tried to break in downstairs one time and damaged it, and they turned up the next morning and fixed it.
Wow. Has it always been red and green?
Yeah,
it
has.
Sup, Dragoons, and welcome. Good morning. A great deal of good morning, that's how I said in the last vlog. Guys, I really want you to enjoy this, so sit back, relax, and enjoy the show.
You know I'm back, like I never left.
I never left.
Another sprint, another step.
Another step.
Another day, another breath. Been chasing dreams, but I never slept.
I
got a new attitude and a lease on life is a peace of mind. Seeking to find, I can sleep when I die. Want a piece of the pie, got the keys to the ride and shit. I'm straight. I'm on my way. I'm on my way. Get up my wake. I'm running late. What can I say? I heard you die twice. Once when they bury you in the grave. And the second time is the last time that somebody mentions your name. So when I leave here on this earth, did I take more than I gave? Did I look out for the people? Or did I do it all for fame? Legend is Exodus, searching for euphoria. Trudging through the mud to find the present, no ignoring us. Got 20,000 deep up in the street like we some warriors. My mama told me never bow your head.
I feel glorious, glorious. Got a chance to start again. I was born for this, born for this. It's who I am, I could have again. I made it through the
focus.
Come on, mate.
Focus, Sesame.
We made this to a start late and then another tour at 1 o'clock.
focus sesame. I wish that would work with this camera. Focus sesame. Yeah, exactly. We've got plenty of stairs at our house. Is that like a killer whale?
No.
Or is that a blue? Oh, I can't even get it. There we go. Oh, we're all zoomed out. Oh. Oh no, there we go. Oh, that was epic. That was really cool. Is that the power battery thingamajig?
That's the fan, yeah, that sort of cools it down.
Yeah.
The batteries are in the cupboard.
Can I grab a pic of that? Can I grab a picture of that? That. Awesome. See you guys.